Random House Audio presents Infected, a novel written and performed by Scott Sigler. More information on the author is available at www.scottsigler.com. This novel contains mature situations, language, and lots of violence. Listener discretion is advised. Prologue. This is the place. Alita Garcia stumbled through the dense winter woods, blood marking her long path, a bright red comet trail against the blazing white snow. Her hand shook violently. She could barely make a fist out of her talon-like fingers, nearly numb, wet from the big clumps of snow that fell thick and fast all around her, melting almost as soon as they hit her skin. When the time came, could she even pull the trigger on Luis's old revolver? A searing pain in her stomach brought her thoughts back to the mission, the divine mission. Something was wrong. Well, fuck, it was all wrong, and had been, from the first moment she'd started scratching at her belly and her elbow. But something was even more wrong. Something inside. It wasn't supposed to be like this. Somehow, she knew that. She looked behind her, along the bloody path through the snow, eyes searching for pursuit. She saw nothing. She'd spent years in fear of the INS, but it was different now. They didn't want to deport her. Now they wanted her dead. Her hands and legs oozed blood drawn by scratching branches. Her left foot bled thanks to the shoe she'd lost some time ago. The snow's thin, jagged crust made every step a cutting crunch. She didn't know why her nose bled. It just did. But all those things were trivial compared to the blood she vomited every few minutes. She had to go on. Had to go on. Find the place. The place where it would all begin. Alita saw two massive oak trees, reaching out to each other like centuries-old lovers, a freeze frame of perpetually denied longing. She thought of her husband, Luis, again, and thought of the baby. Then she pushed those thoughts away. She could think about that no more than she could think of the nasty thing on her belly. She'd done what she had to do. Three bullets for Luis, one for the baby, one for the man with the car. That left one bullet. She stumbled, then tripped. She reached out to try and stop her fall, but her bloody hands punched through the knee-deep snow. Her frigid hand hit an unseen rock, bringing more flaring, cold, numb pain, and she dropped headfirst through the white crust. She came up, wet snow and ice sticking to her exhausted face. Then she threw up, again, blood gushing from her mouth to splash bright red against the white snow. Blood and a few wet chunks of something black. Inside it hurt. It hurt so bad. She started to get up, then stopped and stared at the twin oak trees. They dominated a natural clearing, bare branches a sprawling, skeletal canopy at least 50 meters across. A few stubborn, dead leaves clung to the branches, fluttering slightly in the winter wind. She hadn't known what she'd been looking for, just that she had to walk into the woods, deep into the woods, where people didn't go. This was it. This was the place. Such a long journey to wind up here. She'd taken the man's car back in Jackson. The man had said he wasn't La Migra, wasn't the immigration police. But those people had chased her all her life and she knew better. He had stared at the gun, said he wasn't La Migra, said he was just looking for a liquor store. Alita knew he was lying. She had seen it in his eyes. She had left him there, taken his car and driven through the night, then abandoned the car in Saginaw. There, she hopped a freight train and just started watching for big woods. As long as she kept moving mostly north, it didn't matter. Moving north, really, was the story of her life. The farther north you went, the fewer questions people asked. Childhood in Monclova, Mexico, teenage years in Piedras Negras. Then at 19, she snuck across the border and started moving through Texas and beyond. 7 years of working, hiding, lying, always moving north. She'd met Luis in Chickasaw, Oklahoma. Then together they'd worked their way through America. St. Louis, Chicago, joining her mother in Grand Rapids, Michigan. A brief change, heading east when Luis found regular construction work in Jackson. Then the itching started. And not long after, the urge to move north again. No, not just an urge, as it had been before. The itching made it a mission. But finally, after 27 years of life, she could stop moving. She stared at the oak trees. The way they reached out to each other, like lovers, like husband and wife. She couldn't stop thinking of him anymore, couldn't stop thinking of her lease. But it was okay now, because she could join him. She looked back one more time. The thick, falling snow was already covering the comet path, turning the red to a fuzzy pink, soon to be all white again. Lemegre was looking for her. They wanted to kill her. But unless they were only 15 or 20 minutes behind, her trail would soon be gone forever. Alita turned again to stare at the trees one more time, the image a glorious sculpture in her brain. This is the place. She pulled the old .38 revolver out of her pocket and pressed the barrel against her temple. When she pulled the trigger, her cold fingers worked just fine. Chapter 1. Captain Jinky.
FM 92.5 Morning Call-In Line, what's on your mind?
I killed them all.
Marcia Stubbins groaned. Another I'm-so-funny asshole, trying to take the weird route to get on the air.
Did you now? That's nice, sir.
I have to get on with Captain Jinky. The world has to know.
Marcia nodded. It was 6:15 a.m., just about time for the loonies and the jerks to roll out of bed, hear Captain Jinky and the Morning Zoolanders goofing off in the air, and feel they had to be part of the show. This happened every morning. Every single morning.
Captain Jinky has to know what, sir?
Has to know about the triangles.
The voice was soft. The words came between big breaths, like someone trying to talk just after an intense workout.
Right. The triangles. Sounds more like a personal problem, sir.
Don't you patronize me, you stupid cunt!
Hey, you don't get to scream at me like that just because I'm a phone screener, okay?
It's the triangles! We have to do something! Put me out with Jinky or I'll come down there and I'll stick a fucking knife in your eye!
Uh-huh. A knife in my eye. Right.
I just killed my whole family, don't you get it? I have their blood all over me! I had to, because they told me to!
This isn't funny, you idiot, and by the way, you're the third mass murder that's called here this morning, and if you call back, I'm calling the cops.
The man hung up. She sensed he was getting ready to say something, to scream at her again, right up until she said the word cops. Then he hung up and hung up fast. Marcia rubbed her face. She'd wanted this internship, and who didn't? Captain Jinky had one of Ohio's highest-rated morning shows. But man, this phone screening gig, with the crazy calls day after day. So many retards out there who thought they were funny. She rolled her shoulders and looked at the phone. All the lines were lit up. Seemed everyone in the city wanted to get on the air. Marcia sighed and punched line 2. In Cleveland, Ohio, there is a room on the 17th floor of the AT&T Huron Road building, formerly known as the Ohio Bell Building. This room does not exist. At least what's in the room does not exist. On maps, building records, and to most people who work on the 17th floor, room 1712B is just a file storage room. A file storage room that is always locked. People are busy, no one asks, no one cares. It's like millions of other locked rooms in office buildings all over the United States. But, of course, it's not a file storage room. 1712B doesn't exist because it's a black room, and black rooms don't exist. The government tells us so. To get inside this black room, you have to run a gamut of security screens. First, talk to the 17th floor guard. His desk happens to be just 15 feet from 1712B. He's got security clearance from the NSA, by the way, and is perfectly willing to cap your ass. Second, slide your key card through the slot next to the door. The card has a built-in code that changes every 10 seconds, matching an algorithm based on the time of day. This one makes sure only the right people can enter at the right times. Third, type your personal code into the keypad. Fourth, press your thumbprint onto a small gray plate just above the door handle so a fancy little device can check your thumbprint and your pulse. Truth be told, the fingerprint scanner isn't worth a crap, and it can be easily fooled, but the pulse check is handy. Just in case you're a tad overly excited because someone has a gun to your head, a gun that was probably used to kill the aforementioned security guard. If you successfully navigate these challenges, 1712B opens to reveal the black room, and the things inside that also do not exist. Among those goodies is a Norris Insight STA-7800, a computer designed to perform mass surveillance on a mind-boggling scale. The Norris Insight is fed by fiber optic lines from beam splitters, which are installed in fiber optic trunks carrying telephone calls and internet data into and out of Ohio. This techno jargon means that those lines carry all digital communication in Ohio, including just about every phone call made in and out of the Midwest. Oh, you're not from the Midwest. Well, don't.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.